Hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this dissection video we will focus on the osteology that is pertinent to session 12, the pelvic cavity. So we discussed the pelvic girdle in the learning objectives, but let's do a nice review here because this is certainly an area that we all need to be on the same page. The pelvic girdle is officially formed by the paired coxal bones. So this whole area right here is considered part of the coxal bones, as well as the sacrum, or that distal portion of the spinal column. I always think the sacrum is pretty darn distinguishable because of the very obvious sacral foramina that you can see on either side. You can also see a bit of the coccyx, which I'm outlining right here. The coccyx is always pretty variable in terms of what it looks like, but generally you have a larger portion that kind of tapers down to a smaller portion. And the coccyx is important in terms of muscle and ligament attachment for things associated with the pelvic cavity as well as the pelvic diaphragm. The coxal bones are going to articulate anteriorly at the pubic symphysis, so where the two pubic bones or pubis bones are going to articulate. And a symphysis is a type of cartilaginous joint, so you have a little block of cartilage right here, which is very prominent in the anterior portion. And not on your list of structures, but we did talk about in the learning objective videos, are the paired sacroiliac or SI joints, which I am outlining right here. So this is where those coxal bones are going to articulate with the sacrum. All right, now let's focus on this lateral view. And because it's very, I know I'm looking at a lateral view because of the very obvious acetabulum, which is right here. This is where the head of the femur will articulate with the coxal bone to form the hip joint. So if anytime that you can see a really nice view of the acetabulum, you're looking at a lateral view. It also affords a nicer view of the ischium, which is in this region right here. It'll extend a little bit in this ischiopubic ramus. And you can't see the ischium quite as well when you're looking at an anterior view, so this lateral view or a posterior view will show the ischium better. And the most prominent portion of the ischium is the ischial tuberosity. And this looks like a very rugose bump. Sometimes this landmark is referred to as the sit bone, and you would think based on the size of this bump that a lot of things attach here, and you're right. Your hamstrings have a proximal attachment here, so those large muscles of the posterior thigh, and there are also some very robust ligaments attaching at the ischial tuberosity. Some we'll talk about here, and some we'll talk about more in the musculoskeletal portion of the curriculum. Now I want to go a little out of order here in terms of what I have on the list of structures, and I want to focus on this region right here. And this is referred to as the greater sciatic notch. And this is a notch that's actually part of both the ischium and the ilium. The ilium is going to be this larger fan-shaped portion of the ischial of the coxal bone. So the ilium as well as the ischium are going to form the greater sciatic notch. And this notch is so large because lots of things traverse this region, including its namesake, the sciatic nerve, which is the largest nerve in the body. So it makes sense that you're going to have a fairly large notch. But not only does the sciatic nerve move through here, the piriformis muscle actually traverses this region as well, in addition to quite a few more neurovascular structures. The greater sciatic notch ends inferiorly at a region that I'm going to put a little arrow at called the ischial spine. The ischial spine is an important pelvic landmark, and you can actually see these pretty clearly when we look over here at the superior view of the pelvic girdle. So this right here is an ischial spine, this right here is an ischial spine. And you can see how far they project medially, so towards that pelvic viscera. Specifically, these spines, these ischial spines, can be palpated through the vagina, which can be important in a pudendal nerve block. So you can see that, you can see it not only in this lateral view, but you can see it fairly clearly in this superior view as well. The pudendal nerve will actually exit the pelvis through the greater sciatic notch, but then it will almost immediately head back into the pelvic region or the perineal region through the lesser sciatic notch. And this lesser sciatic notch is going to be between the ischial spine and the ischial tuberosity. So I'm outlining it right here. So you can see how the greater sciatic notch is quite a bit larger than the lesser sciatic notch. So again, that lesser sciatic notch is between the ischial spine and the ischial tuberosity. So that pudendal nerve, which is going to enter the pelvic region again through the lesser sciatic notch, is the primary innervation of the perineum. So much more to come on that nerve. So keep that ischial spine and ischial tuberosity in your mind, as these are important attachment sites for two of the most prominent ligaments of the pelvis. The sacrotuberous ligament is going to attach from the sacrum and coccyx down to the ischial tuberosity. So I'm outlining the sacrotuberous ligament here. And you can see it is projecting, this is the ischial tuberosity right here. It's projecting quite posteriorly, as we know about the ischium. You can actually see the femur right here. So we're looking at a side view of the hip joint. So the ischial tuberous or ligament is going to be between the sacrum and coccyx to the ischial tuberosity, whereas the sacrospinous ligament is going to attach from the sacrum and coccyx to the ischial spine. So this is going to be the sacrospinous ligament. You can see the sacrotuberous ligament is a bit more posteriorly placed, and it's going to be longer. And if you're looking at a straight posterior view, it often occludes the view of the sacrospinous. Now, when these ligaments are present, they transform those greater and lesser sciatic notches into the greater and lesser foramina. All right, so right here is where that greater sciatic notch would be, but with the ligaments, it's going to form the greater sciatic foramen. And here between the ischial spine and the ischial tuberosity is where that lesser sciatic notch would be. And when you combine the ligaments, that would make the greater sciatic foramen. So more complete circles or ovals for that neurovasculature that we just discussed to actually travel. So providing additional protection along with the bone, of course, for that neurovasculature. Excellent. You know, I love to talk through the osteology of a session, in particular why we are having you know these structures. So please take time to review. You always have those BlueLink Atlas images that have the labels directly drawn in already, so you can review those as well. Please reach out if you have any questions to myself or any of my anatomy colleagues, and I thank you for your time and attention.